Jesus taught in his parables that some people in the church who expected to be saved would end up being lost when he would return to this world the second time. Jesus spoke of this over and over in his parables. Where does God draw the dividing line between the saved and the unsaved in the church? Stay tuned, we'll see.
Welcome to Steps to Life with Dr. John Grossbaugh.
Sabbath rest is a promise between God and His children.
Bible prophecy tells us that we are living in the last days of this earth's history before Jesus' second coming. Today's program will help you prepare for these coming events. Stay tuned.
Thanks for joining us. There are many people who think that although a lot of the people in this world will be lost because they don't belong to the church, they assume that if you belong to the church, you've made a profession of faith, you're saved. But did you know that Jesus taught in many of his parables that there would be people that would be in the church that would end up being lost? How can that be? Well, we will read one in just a moment. But before we read what Jesus said about the people in the church that will be lost, let's pray and ask the Lord to help us understand what we're going to read from His holy book. Father in heaven, we thank You for the Bible. We thank You for Bible prophecy. And we pray that as we read one of the prophecies of Jesus, that You will give us understanding of mind and thought to understand the things that we're going to read, so that we might not be one of those who profess to be a Christian and end up being lost. We pray in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
We would like to send you a free book entitled, The Two Destinies. To receive your free book, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM88. Have you ever prepared to go somewhere and then have something happen so you could not go? It is very disappointing, is it not? Jesus tells us that the kingdom of heaven is going to be like this. Are you preparing for disappointment? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM88.
When Jesus was sitting with His disciples upon the Mount of Olives, where He gave His great prophetic discourse about the signs of His coming and the end of the world, He also told them a story that would describe the experience of His church, His people that would live just before the end of the world. Here's the story that He told. It says, "Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight a cry was heard, 'Behold, the bridegroom is coming, go out to meet him.' Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise answered, saying, 'No, lest there should not be enough for us and you, but go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves.' And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding. And the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he answered and said, 'Assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming.'" This story is about a Middle Eastern custom of those days. It was customary for those that were invited to the wedding, the attendants, to come, and the bride and the bridegroom would come, and the bridegroom would take the bride to his house. And there they would have the wedding festivities. And in this story, the 10 virgins were waiting for the bridegroom and the bride to come. It was evening, and they had lamps. But the bridegroom didn't come as soon as they were expecting. In other words, the end of the world did not come as soon as the Christians were expecting. And hour after hour went by. They weren't expecting the bridegroom, the end of the world, to be delayed so long. They weren't expecting the bridegroom to be delayed so long. Five of them, however, were prepared for a delay. Jesus said they had extra oil in their lamps. And five were not ready for a delay. They did not have extra oil, and their lamps went out. Finally, at midnight, here the bridal party is coming with torches, lamps, music, and they hear the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, and the 10 maidens seize their lamps. But five of them don't have any light, and they say to the others, "Well, give us some oil. Our lamps are gone out." And the others say, "Well, no, we can't. You go back rather to those that sell and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. The five virgins that were ready went in to the marriage. And afterward, the other five came, and the door was shut, and it says, they came and said, "Lord, Lord, open to us." And he said, "I don't know you, where you are." They received an unexpected denial. They were left standing out in the empty street in the blackness of the night. These two classes of watchers represent the two classes that profess to be waiting for their Lord to come back to this world. They are described as virgins because they profess a pure faith, and they have lamps. The lamps represent the Word of God. The psalmist says in Psalm 119, 105, he says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." So these virgins have the Word of God. They have it, they read it, they know what it teaches. They have the lamp. Not only that, they have oil. Some of them, though, didn't have enough oil. What does the oil represent? There are several things that oil represents in the Scriptures. One of the main things that oil is used to represent in the Scriptures is the Holy Spirit. You can read about that in Zechariah, the fourth chapter. The oil represents the Holy Spirit, and if you receive the Holy Spirit into your life, then you will receive the love of God into your life. This is the way the Apostle Paul describes it. In Romans, the fifth chapter, he says, in Romans 5, "Hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given us." In this parable, the 10 virgins went out to meet the bridegroom. They were all expecting the end of the world to come. They were all expecting Jesus to come back to this world and take them out of this world. They all had lamps. They all had the Word of God, the Bible. They all had vessels for oil. And for a time, they all looked the same. They all had some oil. But even though there was not seen any difference for a time, the time came when a difference was apparent. And just so with the church, with God's professed people who live in the last days of Earth's history, they all have a knowledge of the Scriptures. They have heard the message that Christ is coming back to this world, that He is coming soon. They confidently expect His appearing. But as in the parable, a time of delay, a time of waiting intervenes. The end of the world does not come as soon as they had expected. And so their faith is tried. And they go to sleep. And when the cry is heard, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Here he is." Some are not ready. Why are they not ready? They don't have any oil in their vessels. In other words, they are destitute of the Holy Spirit. You see, friend, you can read the Bible, but without the Holy Spirit, the Bible, the truth of the Bible, will not quicken your soul. It will not sanctify your heart. You can be able to quote the commands or the promises of the Bible, but unless the Spirit of God sets the truth home to your heart, your character won't be changed. And without the Holy Spirit, men will not be able to distinguish truth from error. And what the result will be is that they will fall under the masterful temptations of Satan. Who are the foolish virgins? The foolish virgins are not hypocrites. They have a regard for the truth. They believe the truth. They advocate the truth. And they are attracted to other people who believe the truth. The problem is they have not yielded themselves. They have not yielded themselves to the working of the Holy Spirit. They have not fallen on the rock. Jesus Christ is the rock. When you fall on the rock, your old nature then is broken up. The Spirit can only work on your heart according to your consent and desire. If you don't put your trust in Jesus and look and live, then your service to God, your Christianity degenerates into a form. This is the way the prophet described it in Ezekiel 33, verse 31. So they come to you as people do. They sit before you as my people, and they hear your words, but they do not do them. For with their mouth they show much love, but their hearts pursue their own gain. Notice what Ezekiel is talking about here. He's talking about people who are Christians. They profess to love the Lord. They profess to be following Him. They profess to believe the Bible, but it says they hear it and they profess much love. They hear your words. They hear the Word of God, but they don't do it. They hear it, but they don't do it. Now, you're probably aware that the apostles taught very clearly, you can read it in Acts 5, that it's those that obey that receive the Holy Spirit. You cannot receive the Holy Spirit just by hearing the Word of God unless you do it, unless you actually do something active to follow the Lord. Notice what Peter said here in Acts, the 5th chapter. It says, we are His witnesses to these things, and so also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those that obey Him. If you're just a hearer of the Word and not a doer of the Word, you cannot receive the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said that only those that are born of the Spirit could have eternal life, could enter into heaven. You can read that in John 3 in the discourse that Jesus gave to Nicodemus. But as Ezekiel said, these people, they show much love and they hear your word. With their mouth they show much love, but they don't obey. They don't do it. He said the very same thing in the next verse, verse 32. Indeed, you are to them as a very lovely song of one who has a pleasant voice and can play well on an instrument. For they hear your words, but they do not do them. Did you know that this is the very problem that the Apostle Paul specifies would be in the Christian church in the last days? Notice how the Apostle Paul described this. In 2 Timothy 3, verse 1 and verse 5, he says, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. And then he lists a whole series of social problems that will occur in the last days, such as children being disobedient to their parents. But then he says, concerning the last days and these perilous times in verse 5, concerning these people that live in the last generation, he says in verse 5, they will be having a form of godliness, but denying its power, and from such turn away. Paul says, in the last days, perilous times will come. People have a form of godliness. They will profess the Christian religion. They will say they are following Christ. They will have the forms of religion, but they will deny the power of it. They won't be doing it. They won't be obedient. They will profess love with their mouth, but their heart will be far from the Lord. They will be pursuing their own gain instead, as Ezekiel said in Ezekiel 33. This is the class of people, the foolish virgins that do not have the Holy Spirit, that in time of danger, when we're right about at the end of the world, they are talking about peace and safety. They are trying to encourage people that you can be saved in your sins. Friends, you can't be saved in sin. There's no place in the Bible that teaches that. The Bible says in Matthew 1, 21, the angel said to Joseph concerning Mary that she shall bring forth a son and you shall call his name Jesus because he shall save his people from their sins. Jesus doesn't save people in sin. There's no salvation in sin. You can only be saved from sin. But the foolish virgins don't have the oil. In other words, they don't have the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Holy Spirit pours out the love of God in our hearts, Paul said. And if you love God, you will keep His commandments, as John said in 1 John 5, 2 and 3. But the foolish virgins don't have the oil. They're destitute of the Holy Spirit. And these are the people that are making the peace and safety cry as we draw near the end of the world. Notice what Paul said about it. He said in 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, "You yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape." Oh, friend, the grace of God has been offered to every soul. But the question is, have you received it? Have you received the Holy Spirit into your life? How can you know that you have received the Holy Spirit? Stay tuned. We'll see it from the Bible.
Sometimes studying the Bible on your own without any help or guideline to follow can be a little difficult. And after confusion and frustration set in, we all too often turn to other things. If this sounds like you, you're not alone. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence School is just the answer. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for your free Bible Correspondence Starter Pack.
I really enjoy being able to study at home. I'm a new Christian, and I definitely knew I needed some guidance.
Simply review each lesson and answer the questions.
These studies were great. It just seemed like the Bible opened up for me.
Then send the completed lesson back to us in the envelope provided.
These studies were very professional. They didn't take a lot of time, and I really appreciated that.
A Bible teacher will then look over each lesson and send them back to you with the next set of studies. It's that simple and totally free. Call Steps to Life Television at 1-800-THE-TRUTH.
I'm so glad I called.
Welcome back. Why is it in the story that Jesus told that the wise virgins could not give oil to the foolish virgins? The reason is, friends, because in spiritual things, no human being can make up for the destitution or lack of another human being. You cannot get into the kingdom of heaven because your preacher or your priest or some religious person that you know has a good religious experience and is filled with the Holy Spirit. You cannot get into heaven that way. It's just like eating. Nobody else can eat for you, and the same way nobody else can receive the Holy Spirit for you. You have to receive the Holy Spirit for yourself. Notice the way it's described right at the end of the Bible so that nobody can miss this point. In Revelation 22, 17, it says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, Come. And let him who hears say, Come. And let him who thirsts come. And whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely." If you want it, you can have it. There is enough grace for every soul in this world. Nobody needs to be lost, but you have to receive the Holy Spirit for yourself. Nobody else can receive the Holy Spirit for you, just like nobody else can eat for you. You have to eat for yourself. You have to receive the Holy Spirit for yourself. No man can impart to another a character that will allow that person into the kingdom of heaven. Notice how this is described by the prophet in Ezekiel 14:20. This is what the Lord says through the prophet Ezekiel. It says, "Even though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, says the Lord God, they would deliver neither son nor daughter. They would deliver only themselves by their righteousness." So, no one can receive the Holy Spirit for you. You have to receive the Holy Spirit for yourself. And if you want to receive the Holy Spirit, you must make a commitment to Jesus as the Lord of your life and as your Savior from sin and choose to obey Him and follow Him. Remember what we read. Acts 5:32, the apostle said, "The Holy Spirit is given to who? Is given to those that choose to follow, to obey the Lord." It is in a crisis that character is revealed. The time came when it was midnight, and the cry went out to the 10 virgins, "The bridegroom is here, go out to meet him." So they arose from their slumber. Both parties were taken unaware, but one was prepared for an emergency, and the other was found without preparation. So it is now, when there is an unlooked-for and a sudden calamity, something that brings your soul face to face with death. Then it will be discovered whether a person has any real faith in the promises of God. It will be revealed whether the soul is sustained by grace. And the great final test comes at the close of human probation, when it will be too late for the soul's need to be supplied. You'll either already have the oil or it will be too late to get it. That's exactly what Jesus taught in this story. The 10 virgins are watching in the evening of this earth's history. They all claim to be Christians. They all have a call. They all have a name. They all have a lamp. They all profess to be doing God's service. They all are apparently waiting for Christ to come back to this earth again. But in the story, 5 are unready. 5 will be found surprised, dismayed, outside the banquet hall. Unfortunately, friend, this is going to happen to many Christians. There will be many in the final day that they will claim admission to Christ's kingdom. And this is what they will say. Jesus predicted in Luke 13 what they would say. He said, Luke 13, 26, "Then you will begin to say, 'We ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets.' But he will say, 'I tell you, I do not know you where you are from. Depart from me, all you workers of iniquity.'" They will say, "Lord, we know that we're saved. We ate with you. You taught in our streets. We know." In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught the very same thing. Notice what it says in Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness.'" What an awful description Jesus gives here. What's the problem? The problem is, friend, that in this life they have not entered into fellowship with Christ. They do not know the language of heaven. They do not keep the law of heaven. They are not filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 2:11. He said, "What man knows the things of a man save the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so the things of God knows no man but the Spirit of God." If you have not received the Spirit, then you cannot understand the things of God or fellowship in the things of God. You cannot have true fellowship with Christ, even if you go to church, if you have not received the Holy Spirit. Jesus said this is fundamental. He said nobody can enter the kingdom of heaven if they're not born of the Spirit. That's what he told Nicodemus in John 3, verses 3 to 5. Oh, friend, do you understand the seriousness of what we're talking about? This is the saddest of all words that could ever fall on a human ear. The words of doom. "I don't know you." Luke 13, 27. You see, what does that mean? That means the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, which you have slighted, which alone could make you one of the joyous throng who is going to go in to the wedding supper, the marriage supper of the Lamb. In that scene, you cannot participate. Why? Because its light would fall on blinded eyes, the melody upon deaf ears. The love and joy would awaken no chord of gladness in the world-benumbed heart. So that person is shut out from heaven, not by an arbitrary decree, but because of their own unfitness for its companionship. Oh, friend, the time's coming. The cry is going to go out, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming. When will that happen? Oh, Jesus said that it happened at midnight. Now, what's midnight? Oh, friend, that's the darkest hour of the night. The coming of the bridegroom comes at midnight, the darkest hour. So the coming of Christ back to our world will take place in the darkest period of human history. We're not talking intellectually, we're talking spiritually. Spiritually, the coming of Christ back to our world will occur in the darkest period of Earth's history. The days of Noah and Lot pictured the condition of the world just before the coming of the Son of Man. The world will be the same way. The Scriptures say it will be the same way when Jesus comes back again. Paul talked about what was going to happen. In 2 Thessalonians 2:9, Paul looked forward to a time at the end of the world. You can see there if you look at the context, he's talking about the end of the world. And he looked forward to a time when he said that Satan would work with all power and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness. Oh, friends, we are living in that time. In the increasing darkness, the multitudinous errors of every sort, heresies and delusions of every sort are upon us in these last days. And not only is the devil leading the world captive, but the most awful thing of all is that his deceptions are leavening the professed churches of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the apostasy which we see in the Christian church today will develop into a darkness deep as midnight, impenetrable as sackcloth of hair. That's where we're headed, friend. It will be a short night of trial and weeping and trouble for God's children for the truth's sake. But out of that night, at midnight, the Lord is going to come. We're living in the time when there's a darkness surrounding our world. The darkness is a misapprehension, misunderstanding of God's character. But out of this darkness, God wants you, if you are a Christian, to be a light. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." The question comes to you and to me today. Do you have the oil? Do you have the Holy Spirit? And as a result of having the Holy Spirit, do you have light? Are you letting your light shine before others so that they can see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven? Are others learning what God is like from you? That is the challenge to you, friend, if you claim to be a Christian in these last days.
We hope you have received a blessing from today's program. We would like to send you a free book entitled The Two Destinies. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer IM88. Are you preparing yourself for disappointment? Are you preparing to have Jesus say to you, "I do not know you"? There are people who have been preparing all their lives to be part of the marriage supper, but they will not be able to go. How can you know that you will be admitted to that great banquet? What are the requirements? What does the Bible say about this very important topic? How can you be sure that Jesus will say to you, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant"? Simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH, that's 1-800-843-8788, and ask for offer IM88. Call now.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Television with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1-2. Check 1-2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5.
Steps
4.
To Life Television, a ministry preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.
He can change your life.